Taking a new, brand new bass out for a spin here. It's the new Henrik Linder signature CNC Mattisson Series 1. We are talking about, production models here, CNC made. These are the first prototypes. Four string, which I'm playing right now. I have a five string in the rack over here. Maybe I'll get that out a bit later. Should be very clear that these are prototypes, not the final thing, but it's just beautiful to see the playability of the instruments. And just, it's such an unknown quantity for me, like going into the process of making a production instrument. I've never done this before with a company, and just really so much hope in that sense. That the basses are so playable, like it's instant. This is a brand new bass, something I've never played before, apart from like 2 seconds at the NAMM show, and I'm finally getting a controlled environment to do that in, and it's instantly playable. Neck feels amazing. I'd be hard pushed at first look to tell you this was a CNC bass. So it's nice, the happy bonus of the NAMM show that I got to hang on to these basses for a couple of days, share them with you guys, I guess, and just see, kind of get a ballpark idea of where my own CNC instruments are going to come out in terms of quality and playability. And okay, it definitely needs a setup, I think, because these were literally just constructed right before the NAMM show and thrown on the booth. So I think, yeah, the D string, this action in general is a little low. I know Henrik has his action a lot lower than mine, so I'm just kind of playing them exactly as is, out of the box, so to speak. And if I understand this correctly, it's two jazz pickups and one set of P pickups in the middle, which each have their individual tone control, plus a pull pot for active and passive, and a standard three-band EQ of bass, mid, and treble. I'm playing, I think, just on the back pickup right now, and I'm getting texts like crazy here. I'm playing just on the back pickup with in passive mode. And if I go active, a little boost there, and then different kinds of tone here. Open up the tone a bit. A little bit more trebly there. This is all with the EQ flat, by the way. Go back to passive. I go and play it. Let's go both jazz pickups, so the front and back. Give you an idea. All around the instrument. So let's go front pickup only, front jazz pickup. Ooh, super mellow there. Nice, and let's just do the P pickups in the middle. Super fast. fat. And if we go active with those, ooh, get getting some, definitely get a bit of a boost there. Sure my neighbors are loving that. Yeah, so there's a lot going on there, a lot of options. It's like maybe the ultimate studio bass, I think, which I think, I guess, is what Henrik was going for. And I wonder if we do like the classic kind of, how would we do that? Yeah, like the classic kind of Marcus sound. Ah. It's actually definitely easier to play some slap stuff with the lower action. If you know where everything is on a bass. I wonder if these, I think these might be nickel strings. Definitely not used to that. I prefer steels. Speaking of which, check it out. There will be an episode, vlog episode, coming up on these bad boys. Just spoke to DR Strings at the NAMM show, and they gave me a couple of sets to try out. High beams and low riders. We'll have to source a C string on in the correct gauge. They didn't have any at the booth at the show. But really looking forward to checking those out this week. I have nothing but kind of good memories of playing those strings when I was back in Berkeley, back in college, like 20 something years ago. So I'm looking forward to giving those a whirl. Wow. So many tones. I guess we didn't do all three pickups together. Oh, the P kind of rounds out the jazz nicely. It just sounds like a bass. That's like instant tone. Kind of, what more could you ask? Henrik and Anders, you guys did it. What a very nice concept to have in a bass. The neck is so freaking nice as well. Plays really smooth. And access, I have total perfect access to the highest note on the instrument, which is an E up here on a G string, kind of, I guess, standard jazz bass-ish, P bass-ish kind of range. I gotta say, for a bass that's literally, number one, a prototype, number two, was kind of put together, bolted together right before the NAMM show, and I'm guessing didn't have that much of a setup. And number three is like just an unknown quantity at this point because it's a CNC bass and this is the first time it's been made. Boy, is it well intonated and plays great kind of right out the gate. Definitely needs a setup on that D string. Minor detail. I wish I knew how to do that. Ah. Low action, kind of killing me a little bit with the touch. I'm so used to that higher action, bit of an adjustment. But I love it, man, I really love it. Damn, now I wish I could keep hold of it. I thought I was gonna be a temporary custodian. I am gonna be a temporary custodian, but now I wish I was. permanent owner. Although now I'm just really psyched to see my triple P set up with the selector switch and all the kind of P bass-ish vibes that that one's gonna have, like my four string does, like the prototype master build does right now. That's gonna be a lot of fun. I guess this is a little more on the jazz side, I would say, jazz bass side. But I'm loving the fact that that P pickup set up in the middle kind of mellows out the J pickups. All right, enough nerding, enough bass nerding. Those are my thoughts on this bass. Now I really do have to get some practice in. Yesterday was mental. It's actually nice and relaxing in the beginning. Got to go see my buddy, coach San Francisco University tennis team. He's the head coach over there. So we went out to Malibu, had some lunch, but then we had to get to the NAMM show to pick up some new toys at the close of the show. I'm now the proud owner of a SL 212. I've never had the 212 cabinet in the house from Aguilar. I have used it a ton on the road. So that will start to show up on this podcast. I'm going to use that as the practice room podcast rig and still have my other one in the back. Hopefully that will improve the audio quality being picked up in the mic here. And we got a Tonehammer 700 as our new gig rig for me and Chelsea. And I mentioned in Two Bass Hit, new episode of Two Bass Hit podcast is out today. You can go check that out on my channel or wherever you listen to podcasts. And I mentioned in that podcast that I'm going to do what might be the number, vlog number 365. I'm not sure. That could be the one about the little amp that could. My original Tonehammer 500 that's done clear over a million miles with me on the road. Maybe close to a million and a half. I have to go back and look, but definitely a million miles. It's cosmetically kind of beaten up a little bit, although I'm using it right now. You hear it. This is the amp I'm using for this podcast. So obviously no issues with it. Technically speaking, just a little bit cosmetically beaten up. So we're going to switch that out. We're going to leave that one in my studio down here. And we're going to use the 700 as our gig rig, which will be really fun. Have a little bit of extra headroom, perhaps. Haven't used that one too much before. Fun to be practicing on four string as well. Ah. Amazing the action thing here. And the string height is so weird to be playing this low. Like the definition is kind of going. I'm going to do something very unprofessional because the amp is so far away. I'm going to pull the cable out. Hold your ears. Clunk! There you go. It's quick and relatively painless. I'm going to grab... Let's grab the 5-string just for 2 minutes. Give you guys a look at that. Oh, yeah. Okay. Let's tune this puppy up. How? Oh, it's actually pretty in tune. That'll work. Okay, one more bump. Here's your warning. I'm gonna put this quarter inch straight in the bass. There we go. And it's all over. Let's see here. Same pickup configuration, everything. But now got that low B in there. Okay, and yeah, string spacing a little different from what I'm used to. I play obviously a little bit tighter. So this is a little bit more towards, I'm guessing, 18 or 19 millimeters. Not sure exactly, so don't quote me on that. But it's definitely a little wider than what I'm used to, and I'm kind of in the 16 and a half, 17 millimeter range. Mm-hmm. These are definitely nickel strings. Maybe those other ones were steel, because these feel a lot softer. And I think these are the Lundgren pickups. I believe that's how you say his name. I believe I met that guy as well at the NAMM show. Same guy who wound the pickups in my Mattisson Triple P. Woo. Fun having a low B. So basically, almost exactly the same bass, just five string model, and there it is. Prototype. Fair warning: I'm gonna pull the quarter inch out of the bass. Boom. Again, prototype of Henrik's. Now I'm gonna get back to my comfort zone. And grab my five string. And really try and get some work done. I keep saying I'm going to do. So close to being done with Bob Reynolds' record. That's why I'm a little bit rushed today. We're doing some synth overdubs in the studio, which I'm really looking forward to. I'm pretty close on tuning as well. All right, here comes the quarter inch. Boom. And we're in. Are we in? There we are. Boom. Okay. Where is everything? Did everything got moved? Okay, back to home here. Oh. Exactly. Okay. Yeah, and NAMM show and just working all week, really didn't get a chance to practice so much. Chops are feeling a little bit rusty, I have to be honest. Oh, I might be getting a flat battery. Okay, that's always fun. maybe a little flat battery for the active pickups, but also looking at different pickup options to get the poles kind of a little more centered, get the string centered between the poles on the C string here. So many things came up at NAMM, so many nerdy things, kind of options. Played a couple of cool random basses as well. Kerry Nordstrand did a copy of the Goya Panther, and that felt really good. Hopefully I get to go visit his workshop and actually check those basses out in a controlled environment. I love my Goya Panther. I play it a bunch, but it is a little temperamental in terms of the switches and the wiring and just it being a bass that's 50 years old or something. So might be cool to have one of Kerry's basses in the rack. Be a little more stable for playing on records and stuff. Was anyone else out there at NAMM? I know I met a bunch of people who listened to the podcast. That was great. Thank you so much for coming up to say hi. That's always awesome. Always awesome to hear there are people out there. Text going off like crazy here again. Thank you. fingers kind of centered again and loose. I'm gonna take my watch off here. Stretch the fingers a little bit. Get the wrists loose. Feels quite exciting having the prospect of being dialed in with one string company. Like, as I'm playing here, I'm like, what strings are these again? Like, I've lost track of which strings are on my bass, just grabbing some out of the string closet and just putting them on. So inconsistent. The whole thing of forgetting what you were working on most recently and trying to remember to dial that back in. Why have I forgotten that as well? Do I have that book handy? No, it's written. I can picture the book that lick is written in, and I can remember that it's in the key of D. Let me see if I can find that book. Not immediately visible somewhere. That's too bad. Oh, I'll dig it out for the next episode and try and bring that lick. Woo, yeah. Bring that lick back to life. It's from anyone who's interested. I think it's from Night Jessamine. Something like that, off the Michael Brecker quintet record. It's this groove in D, like. What is it? Something like that, but I want to remember exactly what the end was. It was a really cool way of moving around outside the harmony and getting back in again. Oh yeah, that was that as well. Okay, now what was it? Yeah. 1, 2, 3, 4, 1. As well, 2, 3, 4. Just a little square that way. 1, 2, 3, 4, 1. That's a little more motion to it on beat 2. 1. Thank you. it's a question of working that idea inside and outside. Holy shit. With the text messages already. I'm going to put that on super silent. It's already on do not disturb. Damn. Okay. Let's try and leave. We will have peace and quiet for a minute. Definitely missing my loop pedal this morning because all my pedals are still packed because I'm about to go over to the rig doctor to see Mason and measure out the pedal board for the new build. So I don't want to set it all up and then break it down again. Oops. And yeah, so just practicing clean. What is that? Oh, something is vibrating. It's not my bass. It's a frequency. Something in the room is vibrating. Oh, that's a relief. Watch? Could have been the watch. Huh. Okay. Okay. Kind of blasting through a few different ideas. Just kind of looking for, I often try a bunch of different things like this, things you've probably heard. If you've listened to the podcast, you've probably heard a bunch before. But I kind of cycle through a bunch of different exercises looking for any holes, looking for any like major deficiencies. Any chinks in the armor. Oh, that's high. Come on. Okay. A, so we'll go to D now. I think I started on F. Let's go through all 12 keys. Go G. Oops. Yes, C. Oh. Wrong. Oh yeah, you feel the workout now as well. So much easier playing Henrik's bass. Now I'm really getting a workout, getting some blood moving here. Last one. F. B flat. E flat. A flat. D flat. B, high, low, high, low. Important to do that go around cycle of fourths on something, not just do something in half steps up and down, so you really feel what the shape, you really hear what the shape sounds like in all areas of the neck, and really trying to do same thing down the octave if it's an option, you know. Yeah, okay. Yeah. Fingers feel good, nice and warm. We might finally be coming out of the freezing wasteland that has been Southern California out here in the desert for the last couple of weeks. Actually, not so bad this morning. My t-shirt, practice room t-shirt. Check these bad boys out. Super soft as well. First time I'm wearing this blue one. Freaking awesome. That is available below this video. Teespring, check out Janek Gwizdala, Two Bass Hit, or The Practice Room on Teespring, and it's linked below YouTube video, as is our Book of the Month. Probably should have mentioned that up front. Book of the Month is Bass Player's Guide to Looping this month. Every month we're doing one book, 50% off, no discount code needed. It is on sale, front page of the store, store.janekgwizdala.com. Bass Player's Guide to Looping. It's also half off on Amazon for anyone who wants a physical copy. We figured out how to do price changes on Amazon so we can do sales and stuff on Amazon as and when we want to run a promotion. So right now, Amazon.com for the rest of this month, January 2020. Bass Player's Looping, physical and digital copies are 50% off. Go check them out. They're linked below this video. Yeah, quick one today. Got to get back to it. Finish some editing. And go overdub some synth stuff with Ruslan for Bob's new album today. Super fun. We'll probably be showing some of that on Instagram later if you guys are following along. Follow at Janek Gwizdala on Instagram. Follow at twobass.hit. That's my podcast with Chelsea. Latest episode, episode 7, is up and running as of late last night. We break down everything we saw at NAMM, the good, the bad, and the ugly, and talk about all kinds of cool, nerdy pickup related stuff. So go check that out and see you guys on the next one.